Orion presents The Italian Fiancé by Victoria Springfield, read by Victoria Fox. Chapter 1. Dozens of tiny golden hearts were scattered across the floor. Lisa had to use a stubby fingernail to prise them off the coir doormat, one by one. She popped them back into the hastily torn open envelope and studied the invitation. Two gold hearts entwined. A simple border and elegant script. It was quite modern, not the sort of design she imagined her elderly aunt would choose. The doorbell rang. Lisa didn't need to look up to know who was standing on her doorstep. She opened the front door. Her younger sister marched straight in, a frown etched on her beautiful forehead.
"So, you've had yours too?"
Cassie pointed the toe of her shoe at an errant gold heart wedged in the doormat's bristles. "And good morning to you," Lisa murmured. Cassie brushed past her into the kitchen, turned on the cold tap at full strength, and began filling Lisa's kettle.
"Coffee,"
Lisa said. She reached into an overhead cupboard for her cafetiere and two mugs.
"So, what are we going to do about it?"
Cassie said. "Do about what? What do you mean?"
"This is a wedding invitation, Lisa,"
Cassie said. "I realize that," Lisa said slowly.
"Aunt Jane thinks she's going to marry this Italian fellow. He's an artist, for goodness sake. And he's called Luciano. What a ridiculous name. She can't marry him, Lisa. We've got to stop her."
Lisa pressed the plunger down on the coffee pot. She fetched the milk from the fridge, buying time. Cassie drummed her French manicured fingernails on the wooden table. Tiny beads of perspiration glistened above her upper lip.
"Don't you think Aunt Jane is old enough to do what she likes?" Lisa said.
She put the two coffees on the table and waited for the explosion.
"She's not choosing a new hearthrug, Lisa. This is serious."
Cassie snapped a chocolate digestive in half viciously.
"She's in love," Lisa said.
"In love? She's 70.
Cassie sprayed a fine mist of biscuit crumbs across the table.
"There's no age limit on falling in love,"
Lisa added.
"She hardly knows him. She met him on holiday. A holiday romance at her age, for heaven's sake. Now she's living out in Italy and she's talking about putting Sundial Cottage on the market. She says she's going to move to Italy for good. It's obvious she's not thinking straight."
"Perhaps it was love at first sight," Lisa said.
"I didn't think you believed in that sort of nonsense."
"I don't, but other people do."
"Aunt Jane isn't other people. Things like that don't happen to Jane. She's always been so sensible."
Lisa looked at her sister.
70 years of being sensible is enough for anyone."
"Don't be flippant, Lisa. Aunt Jane is being exploited. This man is manipulating her."
Cassie twisted the end of her fishtail plait violently. Tears formed in her clear blue eyes. Lisa touched her sister's arm.
"It's been nearly 10 years since she lost Uncle Eddie. She's probably lonely. This Luciano chap."
"She's got us," Cassie interrupted.
"That's not the same thing at all.
Now she's found herself a partner, someone to share her life with.
And if it doesn't work out, so what? Not everything lasts forever."
"What do you mean, so what? We're not all like you, Lisa, drifting from one disastrous love affair to another."
"Thanks a lot."
"Sorry, I shouldn't have said that," Cassie said.
She glanced down at the table. "What does Paul say about it?" Lisa did not want to dwell on her own situation.
"Paul says we shouldn't interfere, but I know he agrees with me that this whole marriage idea is ridiculous,"
Cassie said, but she avoided meeting Lisa's eyes. Lisa wasn't surprised. Cassie would never admit that she and Paul weren't in total agreement.
"Since we got married, Paul and I haven't spent a night apart, but this is an emergency," Cassie said. "Besides, someone needs to stay at home. We've got 3 sets of builders coming round to quote for the kitchen extension."
"Stay at home?" Lisa was confused.
"A when you and I go to Italy.
The wedding's not till after Christmas. Even you don't need to start planning yet, Lisa said.
We're not going to sit back and wait until December.
Cassie's voice rose at least an octave.
We've got to go to Italy now. We've got to go and put a stop to this.
It would be nice to go and meet Luciano, I suppose, Lisa said. But I thought Aunt Jane said the apartment was quite small. We don't want to impose.
We're not going to stay with them. That would imply we approve. I've asked Paul to research a small hotel in Lucca for us. He likes doing that kind of thing.
And getting a bargain, Lisa said.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Of course not, Lisa said quickly. Okay, you can count me in. Let me know when you've checked on the flights. Lucca is in Tuscany, isn't it? It's supposed to be a beautiful part of Italy. I've always wanted to go.
It's not a holiday,
Cassie said. She picked up her tan leather shoulder bag. Of course not, Lisa said. She kissed her sister on both cheeks, inhaling Cassie's fresh floral scent. Cassie reversed her hatchback down the drive. Lisa stood on the doorstep, smiling and waving. The car disappeared. Lisa let out a sigh of relief. She had begun to find Cassie's visits increasingly draining, even when they were as short as this one. How different things used to be. Lisa still remembered the day that her parents had brought Cassie home wrapped in a cream waffle blanket edged in satin. Aunt Jane had told her that Cassie was Mum and Dad's new baby, but three-year-old Lisa knew better. Cassie belonged to Lisa, a gorgeous pink present, a funny little real-life doll. As they were growing up, Cassie granted Lisa almost godlike status. Cassie wanted to walk like her, talk like her, and dress like her. Even at the age of 10, Cassie only wanted to wear the clothes that Lisa picked out, and she begged her older sister to style her hair with Lisa's prized straighteners. And when Lisa was a gawky, knock-kneed 13-year-old with a smattering of spots, in Cassie's eyes, she was still the epitome of sophistication. Lisa no longer wanted or needed Cassie to hang on her every word, but it would be nice if, just sometimes, her younger sister would treat Lisa as a woman of nearly 30 who was capable of making her own life choices, not as some errant teenager in need of guidance. Cassie didn't seem to realize that not everyone aspired to a spanking new semi-detached house and a husband who worked in finance.
We're not all like you, Lisa, drifting from one disastrous love affair to another,
Lisa mimicked under her breath. So what if her life was shambolic by her younger sister's standards? That didn't give Cassie the right to judge. She knew she should try to shrug it off, but the comment still stung. Lisa put the two used coffee mugs by the side of the kitchen sink. She would wash up later. A week in Italy sounded wonderful, but a whole week with her sister, that would be hard. Lisa loved her sister, of course she did, but she wasn't sure she liked her very much. Cassie parked her little red car and double-checked she had engaged the handbrake. She opened her front door. There was a pleasing scent of wood polish in the hallway. It was so nice to be home. Lisa's flat was so untidy, and it certainly wasn't Cassie's idea of clean. She'd spotted a cobweb clinging to the corner of Lisa's kitchen this morning.
A cobweb?
Cassie shuddered. She didn't know how her older sister could live like she did. No spider would dare set up home in her house. Cassie picked up her pen and crossed Visit Lisa off her to-do list. Marinade beef, put on dark wash, weed front border. It didn't promise to be a terribly exciting Saturday morning, but it made sense to get those jobs out of the way whilst Paul was out playing golf. She looked longingly at the pile of glossy brochures lying on the kitchen counter. She could spend hours flicking through the pages of shiny new appliances. Those big American-style fridges were the stuff of fantasies. It was a good thing she had Paul to rein her in. Her initial plans for the house extension were way over budget. The thought of Paul made Cassie smile. It was unusual to marry at 23 these days, but Paul ticked all the right boxes. He was tall, well-spoken, had a job with good prospects, and he was also kind and caring. Moreover, though she hated herself for being so shallow, he was so very good-looking. They had met 5 years ago at a black tie charity dinner where she had been handing out the laminated name badges. She could not help noticing the way Paul's broad shoulders filled out his tuxedo as she helped him fasten the safety pin. A little thrill had made her shiver as she looked up into his piercing blue eyes and said to herself, James Bond. Paul was an accountant, not a government agent, but at least he didn't have to go away on any secret assignments. It was a shame he didn't get to wear a dinner jacket very often, but he was still just as handsome, even in his dad-style V-neck golfing sweater. She hummed along to Radio 2 as she mixed half a teaspoon of crushed garlic into the marinade. Paul would open a nice bottle of red tonight. After 3 years of marriage, she knew him inside out. How lucky she was to have such an ideal husband. If only she could find a man like Paul for Lisa. Lisa was nearly 30, but she was still running around with unsuitable men. Her last partner was a poet. All he seemed to do all day was stare out of the window and scribble whimsical thoughts. Max was 36. Surely that was old enough to realize he should go out and get a proper job. But worse than that, Max was always late. He rarely returned texts, and when he and Lisa had rented a cottage in Cornwall with Cassie and Paul, he had worn the same floral shirt 3 days in a row. Cassie wrinkled her nose. Thank goodness he'd gone. Lisa claimed she wasn't too bothered. She always said that she never wanted to settle down. Cassie hadn't worried too much about her sister. She had always believed that people became more sensible with each passing year. Then Aunt Jane took up with an Italian artist and blew that theory out of the water. Poor Aunt Jane. They should have realized how vulnerable she was now that Mum and Uncle Eddie were gone. Jane truly believed this Luciano fellow was in love with her. But what was he really like? Only last week, Cassie had read a dreadful story in the Daily Mail. A dear old soul had been taken in by a smooth-talking Sardinian waiter. She believed they were going to be together forever until he was unmasked as a bigamist. When she thought of the cruel way he had manipulated a sweet old lady's emotions, it brought tears to Cassie's eyes. She couldn't bear to think of Jane's heart being broken. If only she or Lisa had taken Mary's place and accompanied Jane to Florence, her aunt would never have got into this predicament. Cassie stretched a piece of cling film over the surface of the beef and put the dish on the bottom shelf of the fridge. She climbed the stairs to the spare bedroom, began to sort the dark clothes from the whites, and piled them into her woven plastic laundry basket. Chapter 2. The tall yellow buildings were casting long shadows on the far side of the Piazza Amfiteatro. The waiting staff stood gossiping outside Pizzeria Zaza, resigned to their dwindling clientele. The tourists and locals were now congregating on the sunny side of the oval-shaped piazza, where the bars were doing a brisk trade, and only the odd puddle attested to the afternoon showers. Jane arrived at Galleria Guinigi, just as Viviana was pulling the dark green metal shutter down over the door. She was always glad to see the gallery's young manageress. Viviana and her mother Livia had been so kind since Jane's arrival in Lucca, helping her with all kinds of practicalities and lifting her with their wise words when Jane was having a wobble about the huge life change she had set in motion. "Ciao," Jane called. Viviana straightened up. She smoothed down her black tunic and tucked her short, chic hair behind her ears. "Ciao, Jane. Luciano asked me to tell you he's gone straight to the studio." Jane smiled. Studio was rather a grand description of the spare room on the top floor of Luciano's split-level apartment. "Thank you, Viviana. I mean, grazie. How was today?" "Surprisingly busy. We saw two of Luciano's pencil sketches and a pair of Alonso's earrings."
"Fantastico," Jane said.
The word sounded so ridiculous. She wondered how long it would take her to say anything in Italian without feeling horribly self-conscious.
"Are you okay, Jane?"
Viviana asked.
"Yes. Yes, of course."
Jane's hand instinctively tightened around the leather handle of her nylon tote bag. The mobile phone inside vibrated gently. Jane ignored it. She would answer Cassie's latest message in her own good time.
But there is something on your mind, Viviana said.
Yes, my two nieces are coming to visit, Jane said.
Oh, that's a wonderful news.
Yes, of course it is.
But there is a problem.
Viviana was eyeing Jane with concern.
It's nothing, Jane said.
Of course, I do not mean to pry.
Jane sighed. Keeping her feelings to herself didn't seem to be the Italian way.
I'm terribly fond of Lisa and Cassie. They're lovely girls. They were a tower of strength after Eddie passed away. I don't know what I would have done without them. And we've been even closer since my dear sister died. They always supported me, whatever I decided to do. But since I moved here,
they don't approve.
They act as if it's a phase I'm going through. They don't trust me to make my own decisions.
Ah, and now you are getting married.
I'm so happy, Viviana, but it is a big decision. Perhaps they are right to be concerned.
They have their own families?
Cassie's been married 3 years, but no children yet. She's 26, about your age. Lisa's nearly 30 now. She's not the type to settle down. At least that's what she says.
When they come here, they will meet Luciano and see how happy you are. Then they will be happy too.
The younger woman beamed.
Of course, you're right, Jane said.
She had a feeling it wasn't going to be quite that simple. Jane unlocked the door to Luciano's apartment. Their apartment, she had to remind herself. She dropped her tote bag onto the kitchen table. The smell of oil paint hung in the hallway. Puccini's Nessun Dorma was blasting from the ancient turntable in the attic studio on the top floor. Her sandals made a clip-clopping sound as she climbed the bare wooden stairs. Luciano was standing at his easel, his bulky frame and wild explosion of steel-gray hair half obscuring the large canvas he was daubing with blue paint.
Chiesa San Michele,
Jane said above the music. Luciano spun around. Flecks of paint splattered onto the terracotta-tiled floor. He wiped his brush on the front of his trousers.
Yes, you are right. The facade of this church is unmistakable, however poor the artist's work.
No, this is good, Jane said.
It's not too bad, I admit, but however many times I tried to capture this church, there is a certain something that eludes me.
He turned down the volume on the record player.
I didn't mean to interrupt you.
But I am very glad that you did. Come here.
He put his arms around her and brushed his lips against hers. His beard felt rough against her cheek.
Let us go out. I have done enough for today,
he said.
No, wait.
He turned up the music.
This is my favorite part. We must dance. Let me clean my hands.
He picked up a well-used rag.
Now put your feet on top of mine and lean against me. You will not fall. I shall hold you.
Jane laughed. She stepped onto Luciano's paint-splattered boots and balanced precariously as he began to waltz her around the room. She never ceased to be surprised at how small and slight she felt when he held her against him, and how safe.
Deluga, notte,
he sang in his deep baritone, twirling them both around, missing the easel by inches.
Stop, she laughed. You're making me dizzy.
He stopped dancing, gripped both sides of her waist and lifted her up until her head nearly touched the sloping ceiling. She caught sight of herself in the large gilt mirror on the wall behind them. Her face was red, her newly dyed hair all mussed up. She hardly recognized herself.
Vincero, Vincero, Vincero,
he sang the final words. The record player clicked off, signaling the end of side one.
You're crazy.
But that is what you like about me,
he grinned.
So, shall we go out? Where shall I take my beautiful fiancé this evening?
We could try Da Giacomo, but I must get changed. Just look at me.
Jane patted her hair.
Nonsense, one cannot improve on perfection.
He kissed her again.
I, on the other hand, must change out of these trousers. I cannot be seen in such a state with the most beautiful woman in Lucca.
Jane laughed. At first, she'd been embarrassed by Luciano's effusive compliments, had even suspected them to be a form of gentle mockery. But it didn't take long for her to realize that his over-the-top words were an expression of his zest for life. Wherever he went, friends, neighbors, and the local dogs were met with expansive gestures and joyful greetings. Luciano reappeared in clean red trousers. He changed his shirt, too. The striped linen gaped slightly where the material struggled to contain his soft brown belly. There was a streak of green paint in his hair.
Will I do? He asked.
Perfectly, Jane said. She'd decided not to get changed. Her blue shirt dress was cool and comfortable, so she'd contented herself with smoothing down her rumpled skirt and reapplying her pink lipstick and a dusting of face powder. They walked through the shady, narrow streets, her hand in his. The hem of her calf-length dress swished against her bare legs. She glanced up at him. He was a big bear of a man whose physique paid tribute to a lifetime of red wine and pasta. His clothes were unapologetically loud, and his unruly salt and pepper hair lapped the edge of his shirt collar. Perhaps they looked like an odd couple. She was sure Cassie and Lisa would think so. Jane and Eddie had been made for each other. Everybody said so. Her late husband had shared her equitable temperament and her love of books and European travel. As the years went by, they had become more and more alike, pottering in the garden, enjoying the same television series, and finishing each other's sentences. They looked similar too, with their clear blue eyes, slim figures, and neat button noses. Jane had never expected to meet somebody else. She certainly wasn't looking to replace the kind, loving scientist with whom she had shared four decades. There would never be another Eddie. But her relationship with Luciano was something entirely different. To compare the two men would be as pointless as debating the respective merits of Constable versus Picasso, or weighing up the tastiness of a bowl of spicy spaghetti puttanesca against a Sunday roast with all the trimmings. Luciano was different from any man, any person she had ever met. And she was different too. From the day they met, he had uncovered a whole other side to her. A more daring, adventurous side. And now, at 70, she was embarking on the biggest change of her life. A new husband, a new country, new blank chapters to fill with the story of the rest of her life. She had reinvented herself, and no matter how disapproving Lisa and Cassie might prove to be, she wouldn't, couldn't, go back to being the person she had been before she and Luciano met. They passed in front of the red brick Guinigi Tower. The eccentric-looking tower, crowned with a roof terrace of leafy home oak trees, was the sole survivor of the four erected by the wealthy merchants and bankers of the Guinigi family. 232 steps led to the viewing platform on the tower's top. Jane made a mental note to add it to the list of things that might entertain her visitors. It would certainly appeal to Lisa, though it was unlikely she would be able to persuade Cassie to climb up there. Her younger niece had never had a head for heights. They cut through the streets and entered the top end of Piazza Napoleon, the largest square in the town. The Giacomo was tucked just off the square in a corner shaded by a thick canopy of trees. A couple sitting in the corner gave them a friendly wave, and the waiter gave Luciano a hearty slap on the back. He seemed to know everybody. Luciano pulled back a white metal chair for Jane.
May I suggest a Negroni?
The waiter smiled encouragingly.
Jane?
That sounds wonderful.
Two, please, Gianni, Luciano said.
He unwrapped a wooden toothpick and speared one of the green olives in the glass dish in the center of the table. The waiter returned with two large etched tumblers, accessorized with a twist of lemon peel, a glass bowl full of crisps, and an oval platter of crostini arranged on a scalloped edge doily. Luciano crunched into a crostino topped with black olive tapenade.
How was your day, my love?
Successful, I think. I've repotted those herbs on the balcony and finally learnt all the words of the Beatitudes.
Well done. You are ready for choir practice tomorrow.
As ready as I can be, Jane smiled.
But there is something else. You mentioned you had some news for me.
Jane fiddled with the stem of her cocktail stirrer, prodding the ice at the bottom of her glass.
My niece, Cassie, contacted me today. She and her older sister, Lisa, are coming to visit.
That's marvelous. They're like daughters to you, are they not? And now, at last, we will meet. When are they coming?
The day after tomorrow.
Such a short notice. Still, we shall manage. I shall move all those boxes out of the spare room and up to the studio. The lamp is still broken, but we do not really need two in the living room.
They're not going to be staying with us. They've booked a room at the Hotel Tosca.
Luciano's eyes widened.
No, this is not right. You are their aunt. They must stay with us.
Cassie says that they did not want to put us to any trouble. She was most insistent. Besides, they received a special discount from the hotel for paying in advance, so now it's too late.
Luciano shook his head and tuttered.
Not staying with the family. Sometimes I do not understand these English ways, but I am glad not to spend tomorrow moving boxes. I am determined to finally capture the facade of Chiesa San Michele.
And I am going to walk the length of Via Belungo and find my wedding shoes.
You are happy to do that alone?
Luciano asked.
Oh, yes.
I am rather glad you said that. I feel I would be of no use on such a quest.
Luciano smiled.
So, how long will your nieces be staying in Lucca?
About a week, I believe.
Good. That is plenty of time for them to see everything. But they are young. Perhaps they will not want to spend all their time with two old folk.
I could ask Viviana's advice. She's about the same age as Cassie. She is sure to think of some things they will enjoy.
An excellent idea.
It will be good to find something to distract them.
To distract them from what?
Checking up on me, Jane said.
Checking up on you? What on earth are you likely to get up to?
Jane flexed her left hand. Three small diamonds sparkled in the light. Luciano linked his fingers between hers. His gaze fell on her unusual star-shaped ring.
Ah, now I understand. But I think it's me they've come to check up on.
I'm afraid so, she said quietly.
He squeezed her hand.
Am I so bad?
Not at all. I'm sure they'll like you very much, but...
They may not approve of us getting married.
Lisa is very easygoing. I can't imagine her trying to tell me what to do. But Cassie can be very judgmental. I'm afraid they both think I'm a daft old lady who's fallen for a smooth-talking Italian playboy.
I'm sure one look at me will dispel them of that illusion,
Luciano chuckled.
But why are you looking so serious? You're not having second thoughts, are you?
Of course not. You've changed my life.
Luciano caught the eye of the waiter.
A glass of red wine, I think. Those cocktails are rather dangerous. I do not want my fiancé to have to carry me home. Signora?
Just a mineral water, please.
Salute.
Luciano raised his glass.
I love you, Jane.
I love you too, Jane said. And that's all that matters.
Chapter 3. Jane paused in front of the Church of St. Francis, the stark limestone facade, enlivened only by two blind arches and a single rose window, gave no hint of the loveliness beyond. Jane passed to the side of the church and entered the cloisters. She stopped in front of the frescoed lunette above the tomb of Tignosini. There were hundreds of depictions of the Holy Mother and Child in the churches and galleries of Lucca, but this was her favorite. She never grew tired of looking at the butterscotch-colored halos above the heads of Mary and Jesus, the soft brown robe of St. Francis and the merchant, Tignosini, kneeling to receive the Holy Mother's blessing. Jane came to the cloisters at least twice a week. It was such a peaceful place. She loved it when no one else was around, and she could imagine the days when the monks had grown food for the poor in one cloister, feed for the mules in another, and herbal remedies for the monks' apothecary in the last. Now those industrious spaces were replaced by neat, manicured lawns. The scent of freshly mown grass was in the air. If she closed her eyes, she could be back in England, watching Eddie cutting the lawn in his slip-on leather shoes with the sleeves of his old work shirt rolled up to the elbows. She felt a pang of nostalgia. How different her life was now to the years she and Eddie had spent in Honeypot Lane. She had changed too. What would Lisa and Cassie make of it all? She could hardly believe they would be arriving tomorrow. She couldn't wait to see them, but the niggling worries remained. What would they think of Luciano? Would they compare him to their dear Uncle Eddie and find him wanting? Jane left the cloisters, passed the piazza in front of the church, and crossed over the canal that ran along a narrow channel cut into Via del Fosso. She would soon reach the heart of the old town. She tried to push her cares aside and concentrate on the task ahead, shopping for her wedding shoes. Who would have believed she would be doing that at the age of 70? In a few months' time, she would be married to Luciano Zingaretti. Sometimes it seemed like a dream. She turned into the elegant shopping street that snaked its way behind the Piazza Amfiteatro. There was only a handful of shoe shops on Via Filungo, but Jane had allocated the rest of the morning to her quest. Even though she had only moved to Lucca a few months before, she knew that it was impossible to walk down the winding shopping street without bumping into some acquaintance who would waylay her for a long conversation in rapid Italian that Jane could just about follow now that she understood about two out of every three words. And afterwards, whilst her head was still spinning, she would seek out a restorative cappuccino in one of the 19th century cafes where the literary giants of Lucca once gathered. She would work her way through the stories in last night's Corriere della Sera with her little green leather dictionary to hand and wonder if she would ever understand enough of the language to tackle a novel. So far today, the only person she recognized was Viviana's mother, Livia, who waved and called, "See you at the choir practice," as she wobbled past on her bicycle. It was a shame she hadn't stopped to chat. Jane carried on up the road, stopping to look in the window of a smart menswear shop. Luciano would look so handsome in the cappuccino-colored linen jacket in the window, but she knew he would be happier in his old purple number, even though it was dotted with flecks of paint that wouldn't wash out. It would be nice if Luciano dressed up a little, but Jane knew there were benefits to being with a man who was confident in his own skin, rather than one who fussed about in front of the mirror. Besides, she was old enough to appreciate what she had. There were too many women who found a man, then set about trying to change him. Reluctantly, she tore her eyes away from the linen suits in the window. She had to step around two women who were standing in the middle of the pavementless street, showing each other photos on their mobile phones, an activity that apparently required a lot of hand-waving and loud exclamations of delight. Jane picked her way past them, avoiding two elderly gents in neatly pressed polo shirts and belted knee-length shorts who were standing in the road, munching chocolate-flecked ice creams. One had a small white terrier under his arm which was sticking out its pink tongue and trying to wriggle its way towards its owner's dripping cone. She stopped outside a small shoe shop with most of its wares crammed into the window. Browsing took place in the street. There was no need to step inside without an intent to purchase something. Jane scanned the display, which seemed to have been arranged with no noticeable concession to theme or color. She needed white or neutral to go with the pale pink suit she had picked out, but nothing here looked right. She stared at the window and sighed. There was no point in going inside. The small interior contained only a few shoes and sandals on individual, wall-mounted perspex shelves, a couple of bench seats for trying on, and a wooden counter behind which the white-haired proprietor perched on a rickety wooden chair while shaking his head in disgust at the contents of the local edition of Il Tirreno. Jane walked on until she came to the corner of Via San Giorgio. Carlo Alessi was one of the largest shops on the street. A bell rang as Jane pushed open the door. The proprietor was by her side in an instant. The woman was warm and friendly, but quite insistent that Jane could not possibly reject any of her suggestions without trying on the proffered shoes. Jane found herself walking back and forth to the mirror whilst empty cardboard boxes piled up around her. Everything was too high or too low, too plain or too fancy. She was past the age of teetering on spindly heels, but she still wanted something special. Eventually, the saleswoman admitted defeat and turned her attention to two other customers trying on matching stilettos. As Jane left the shop, one of the women struck a pose. The other laughed loudly and clapped her hand to her mouth. Jane felt a pang of loneliness. Looking for shoes by herself wasn't as exciting as she had anticipated. If only her best friend Mary was here, what fun they would have together looking for all the finishing touches to Jane's outfit. Jane turned away from the shop window. She would treat herself to a cup of coffee in her favorite cafe before she tried any more shops. She dropped a couple of coins into the upturned hat of a young girl who was playing a portable keyboard nearby, pushed open the glass doors, and inhaled the aroma of freshly ground coffee and the sweet scent of sugar-dusted pastries. Jane took a seat and ordered a cappuccino. It was cheaper to drink her coffee standing at the bar as Luciano always did. But whenever Jane sank into the comfortable dark red leather banquette at Cafe Patrizia, she felt the extra euro was money well spent. She sat for a while toying with her cup and saucer. There were a couple more shoe shops at the other end of Via Fulungo. She knew Viviana favored a small establishment not far from the clock tower. She would try there, and if she had no luck, she could always take the train into Florence. Perhaps she could persuade Livia to go with her, though she was bound to try to talk Jane into something far too glamorous, unlike dear Mary, who would steer her towards something practical with a capital P. It would be nice to have an excuse to visit Florence again. It was the city where she and Luciano first met, so it held a special place in her heart. Jane had been to Italy several times before. She and Eddie had traveled all over Europe, but on their visits to Italy, they had always stayed by the lakes and mountains that Eddie loved. Jane had ventured abroad occasionally since Eddie's death. A tour of Andalusia, a trip with Mary to see the tulip fields of Holland, a river cruise along the Rhine. But she had never returned to Italy. With her 70th birthday fast approaching, Jane had decided she must, at last, visit Florence and do so at her own pace with no set itinerary to follow. Mary had been due to accompany her. The two of them had had so much fun brushing up their Italian together, researching the places they might see and sighing over the scenery and costumes in a room with a view. At the last minute, Mary's granddaughter had gone into premature labor. Mary didn't want to leave England, and Jane respected her old friend's point of view. It was too late to cancel their trip, so despite Lisa and Cassie's strongly expressed misgivings, Jane had summoned up a determination she didn't know she possessed and went alone. Jane's courage had almost failed her when she crossed the piazza in front of the Santa Maria Novella railway station and found herself in a wave of baseball caps and backpacks heading for the streets surrounding the cathedral and the baptistry. But the small hotel she and Mary had chosen was situated in a quiet residential street on the south side of the river, far from the crowds. Despite the sultry weather, the language barrier, and the almost indecent excess of statues and architectural treasures that surrounded her at every turn, Jane felt almost immediately at home. On her second morning, she strolled across the Ponte Vecchio, past the tourists ogling the jewelry shops that lined the old bridge. Jane had never seen so much gold in one place. She turned towards the grey bulk of the Uffizi, the most famous art gallery in the world. A queue was already forming outside. Some were distracted by a busker with a dancing marionette, but most stared down at their phones. Jane wandered around the perimeter of the building, watching the street artists who made a living from selling their watercolours and sketching the portraits of the passing tourists. Jane hadn't planned to linger, but she was soon drawn into conversation by a scruffy young man standing by a display of fine sketches of Hollywood actresses, whom Jane recognised immediately. The man chatted pleasantly enough until she politely declined his suggestion that she might pose for a portrait. His intense green eyes turned cold. Ignoring her refusal, he picked up a soft brown pastel stick and began to sketch. The approximate outline of Jane's face began to materialize on a sheet of green paper. Jane tried to move away. The man shifted position. Jane tensed. She was trapped between the man and his easel. She looked around. It was broad daylight, and she was surrounded by dozens of people, but everyone was in their own little world. No one noticed her distress. She felt very vulnerable and very alone.
"Is that the man bothering you?"
a voice said. A man stepped out from behind one of the pillars. He was an imposing figure, tall and broad, dressed in old jeans and a loose purple top, something between a shirt and a smock.
"Oh, no, I'm," she murmured.
She hated to make a fuss. The artist stepped away from his easel, advancing on the stranger, spitting out a string of rapid Italian. The two men's voices rose. Jane seized her chance. She walked away quickly, gripping the handle of her shoulder bag. She didn't look back. Jane walked as fast as she could. She had no idea where she was going, but she was confident that she couldn't get lost if she followed the path of the river. Soon the Uffizi Gallery and Ponte Vecchio were far behind her. The sun was hot. She had left her straw hat back at the hotel and her silky blouse was clinging to her back. She crossed the road to take advantage of the shade. A van hooted, making her jump. She had almost reached the next bridge, the pretty Ponte Santa Trinita, when she heard the stranger's voice.
"Signora, please wait."
Jane stopped reluctantly. The man was breathing heavily in the heat. She waited for him to catch his breath.
"I could not let you go without checking that you are okay."
His dark eyes were full of concern.
"I'm quite all right now, thank you,"
Jane said, although she was still feeling quite shaken up. She was about to walk away, but something stopped her.
"It was very kind of you," she added.
"A young Luigi Vasari is a talented artist, but he is a most unpleasant fellow. His grandfather, old Luigi, was just the same."
"You know him?"
"All of us artists know each other."
"You're an artist?"
"Yes, Luciano."
He held out his hand. Jane took it. His handshake was warm and firm.
"Jane, I suppose that you want to draw my portrait now?"
"Not at all."
Jane had no desire to own a portrait of herself, but she felt inexplicably disappointed by the man's reaction.
"I don't draw portraits. But even if I did, I do not think I could do justice to your beautiful face. My easel is over there."
He waved an arm in the direction of the river.
"The great buildings, the churches, the bridges over the Arno, these are my subjects. I have drawn and painted them all a dozen times."
"Like Monet with his views of the Thames,"
Luciano laughed.
"Ah, Claude Monet. I'm afraid my daubings wouldn't stand comparison."
"Well, thank you again. I mustn't keep you," Jane said.
"But you must,"
Luciano said.
"I must buy you a drink to make up for that man's behavior. My friend is keeping an eye on my easel."
"I,"
Jane began.
"I absolutely insist."
Luciano's voice was firm, but his eyes were twinkling.
"Okay," Jane said, "but just a cup of tea."
"A fine English tradition,"
Luciano smiled. So with Lisa and Cassie's dire warnings echoing in her ears, Jane allowed Luciano to lead her through the city streets. After their tea, they walked further along the River Arno, and before she knew it, Jane found herself in a cozy trattoria down a side street lined with parked mopeds that she would never have discovered herself.
"Shall we order more tea?"
Luciano said. Wine, please, but on one condition, Jane said.
And what is that?
He asked. That you choose. Luciano raised his glass.
To newer friends.
New friends, Jane echoed his words. How quickly the evening had flown by. Jane was shocked to realize it was starting to get dark as Luciano walked her back to her hotel. He hummed to himself as they crossed the Ponte Santa Trinita back to the south side of the city. Frenze e come? Jane recognized the tune at once. Luciano stopped walking.
Yes, from Gianni Schicchi. You like Puccini? That is marvelous.
He began to sing the lyrics. He had a clear, deep voice. People were turning and staring. Jane was shocked to realize that she didn't care. Luciano stopped singing as suddenly as he began.
Don't stop, Jane said.
I cannot reach the high notes. You must sing the next part.
Jane clapped her hand over her mouth. She enjoyed singing in the church choir, hidden away in the chorus, but a solo serenade in the street was quite another matter.
No, no,
she laughed.
Then you must do the next best thing. Come and listen to Puccini with me. There is a concert tomorrow in Lucca. It is the town where Puccini was born and the place where I live.
Oh, I couldn't, said Jane. But she knew that she would. And that was how it began. Jane picked up her bag. She had whiled away half an hour drinking coffee and reminiscing. She handed a 5 euro note to the man behind the till and waited for her change. She looked in the mirror behind the row of bottles lined up against the wall and patted her auburn hair into place. She was glad her new Italian hairdresser had persuaded her to tint her hair back to a softer version of its original color. Behind Jane, another woman's face was reflected in the glass, a woman in her 60s sitting alone. The woman's hair was pulled back into a rather severe ponytail. It was jet black, save for a solitary streak of white. An orb-shaped gold pendant nestled between the wide lapels of her violet jacket. An emerald green handbag with a bamboo handle was perched on the table in front of her. Jane's pastel pink floral blouse suddenly seemed frumpy and dull. The man behind the counter was speaking, but Jane hadn't heard a word.
Il suo resto, signora,
he repeated in Italian, then loudly in English.
Your change, madam.
So sorry, please excuse me, Jane said. She put the coins in her leather purse and snapped it shut. The woman with the white streak in her hair was tipping a sachet of sugar into her coffee. How confident she looked, how Italian, so unlike Jane. Would she ever really fit in? But she loved Luciano and he loved her. She knew he did. When they were alone, she had no doubts. Jane let the glass door swing shut behind her. She stepped out into the street and turned back the way she had come. She didn't feel like shopping anymore. She wanted to go home to the familiar comfort of the apartment and potter in the living room with the smell of oil paint in the air and the sound of Luciano's singing drifting down the stairs. Chapter 4. Cassie had to admit that Aunt Jane looked well. Italy suited her. Or perhaps it was just the soft light cast by the wool lamps in the cozy lounge of the Hotel Tosca that was responsible for her glowing complexion.
I would have brought Luciano to meet you straight away, but I thought you'd rather get settled in first.
Yes, you're quite right. We'll need a chance to freshen up, Cassie said.
But we're so looking forward to meeting Luciano, aren't we, Cassie? Lisa said.
Of course we are,
Cassie said. She took a sip of her fizzy water and shot her sister a look. Lisa didn't seem to notice. Jane shifted awkwardly on the damask couch. She twisted the delicate star-shaped ring on her left hand.
Oh, let me see.
Cassie took hold of Jane's hand and examined the ring. It was dwarfed by Cassie's huge emerald-cut sparkler.
It's lovely, she said truthfully.
White gold. Luciano chose it himself.
I've never seen anything quite like it, Cassie said.
A young man, Alonso, designed it, He sells some of his jewellery through the gallery where Luciano sells his paintings.
He's obviously very talented, Lisa said. The gallery sounds wonderful. I hope we get the chance to visit.
Of course. In fact, I thought we would meet Luciano there before we head out for dinner.
Won't it be closed? Cassie said.
Oh, no, the shops here don't close until 7:30 or 8 at night, but they shut for a couple of hours or more in the middle of the day.
How odd.
It's the traditional way. Luciano swears by a proper lunch break and a short siesta.
Sounds like a great routine, Lisa grinned. Cassie didn't reply. A long lunch and a snooze wasn't her idea.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.